Hello, Graham. Welcome back.
Hi, Emiliano. Welcome back too.
How are you today?
I'm good, thank you. I'm in Connecticut, just north of New York City, and mm-hmm. Connecticut is slowly opening up, slowly. I mean, it may close down if things go bad again, which is entirely possible, but the local swimming pool opened. So this week I've got to swim in a couple of times for the first time in 3 months.
That's something. Yep.
Yeah, I mean, you have to see the swimming, right? I don't have that luxury.
Lucky you. Things here, everything, shit is hitting the fan here, so things are can only get worse for the next few weeks at least.
I think you're right.
We'll see. We'll see what happens. Okay, so in our conversations, we mentioned several times negation, of course. Negation is one of the fundamental concepts when it comes to contradictions. But today I would like to focus on negation itself. So we know, or we learn in our mother's knees how to use negation, so to speak. But in the history of thought and the history of logic, there have been several theories of negation, accounts of negation. So to get us started, could you give us a brief survey of these theories?
Yeah. Look, first of all, a comment about learning at our mother's knee. What we actually learn at our mother's knee is how to use the word not or cognate words in other languages, okay? You shouldn't confuse the word not with negation. These are different. The word not in English and cognate languages has many uses, and some of them have absolutely nothing to do with negation. So there's a phenomenon that linguists call metalinguistic negation, which is not a great title if you're a logician, but that's what they call it. And it's when you use negation in this way. I'm not British, I'm Scottish. Or I'm not his wife, he's my husband. Okay. I presume it works like this in most languages. Does it work like this in Italian?
It does. Io non sono europeo, sono italiano. Yeah, it does.
Yeah, so this is what linguists call metalinguistic negation. It uses the word not, but it clearly has nothing to do with negation in the logician sense. If I say, I'm not British, I'm Scottish. Well, of course, if I'm Scottish, I'm British. Okay, what it's doing is kind of emphasizing connotations or implicatures or something. And this is kind of standard way to use the word not. So the word not and its cognates in other languages does not necessarily have anything to do with negation. Of course, it can be used to express a negation, but negation itself is something like a logician's term of art. And as you say, we've seen a number of different accounts of negation offered over the last 2,500 years, particularly with the rise of non-classical logics in the last 50 years or so, I guess. So if you want to categorize different accounts of negation, there are various ways you can draw up the taxonomy. But here's one way which is quite useful, I think. Any notion of negation is going to give you a notion of contradiction, because contradiction is the form P and the negation of P. Let's call it not P, even though I said that, you know, be wary of this word not. So a notion of negation is going to give you a contradiction of the form P and not P. Now, what are the consequences of this? there are three possibilities. Either the contradiction entails everything, or the contradiction entails nothing, or the contradiction entails some things but only some things. And I think that you find theories of all three kinds in the history of Western philosophy. Theories of negation according to which contradiction entails everything are of course familiar, because classical logic, the logic of Frege and Russell, is like that. So people know all about these. The accounts of negation according to which contradictions imply some things but not everything are accounts that you find in paraconsistent logics, relevant logics, and so on. Accounts of negation according to which contradictions imply nothing are kind of less familiar, I think. But I do think that you find examples of this in the history of logic, and even in some sort of 20th century philosophers like Strawson. So one common view which you find in Strawson and Berkeley is that if you say P and then saying not P, you said nothing. You just cancel out everything, right? And if you said nothing, well, then nothing can follow. So this is a rough taxonomy of theories of negation, which you might find in the history of Western logic. But even within that taxonomy, of course, there are differences. So, for example, just consider the count of negation according to which a contradiction implies everything. That's, of course, the principle explosion. We talked about explosion some weeks ago now. You know, there are many contemporary accounts of negation which endorse explosion. Classical logic isn't the only one. Intuitionistic logic does too. And patently, the intuitionistic account of negation is different from the classical account of negation. Some hardcore logicians say it's just not negation at all. I think that's a rather poor move. It tends to assume that classical negation gets it right about what negation is, although this is a theory-driven matter. But even so, I mean, the intuitionist account of negation is a radically different account of negation from the classical account. And just to finish off this rather rambling comment, negation, as I said, is a logician's term of art. As such, you can only understand what negation is by having a theory. This is why we find many theories in the history of philosophy. And of course, we now have many different theories of negation, both medieval and modern. And the question is always going to be, which of any of these is right? Or maybe there's more than one negation. So maybe more than one can be right. So I mean, these are sort of live philosophical issues.
Okay. And then you mentioned that. In fact, one question could be, what are they theory of? So one may think, okay, they're all technical terms. So we have technical notions, different technical notions. And just like we have different kinds of numbers, and we're not tempted to say, well, how can there be different theories of different entities that are all called numbers? And some, in some of your writings, you rather compared the situation with different geometries and their relation to physical reality. So you seem to think that they are actually all theories of something which deserve the name negation. What are they theories of?
No, that's a good question. Look, some things are so basic that you can't define them in terms of anything more fundamental. So the notion of a set, for example, it's really hard to define that in terms of anything except for close cognates, group, bunch, collection, and so on. In the end, we have this kind of notion. We hope that when we talk about it, we have enough commonality of the concept to pick up on it. Similarly, negation is one of a very tightly connected bunch of concepts, such as negation, falsity, contradiction, You can define each of these in terms of the others, but in the end, you know, you can't break out of this loop. You're going to be stuck with this concept, and then we sort of can discuss what that concept is. Do you want me to say more about this, or is that enough?
Yeah, I would like you to say a bit more.
Well, I mean, the way I prefer to think of it is this. Traditional logic, by which I mean the logic of Aristotle in the Middle Ages, distinguishes between contradictories, contraries, and subcontraries. And the way you do this is very familiar. So two things are contraries if they can't both be true, two things are subcontraries if they can't both be false, and something is two things are contradictories if they're both contraries and subcontraries. Now, I think that's a useful thing. So that's not to break out of this circle, that's just to choose one of the things as a starting point, namely contraries and truth and falsity. But I'm inclined to think that negation is a theory of the contradictory relation, the relationship of contradictories. So that's my preferred way of looking at it. But that's not going to break out of the circle. That's just a kind of a gloss which I find helpful often.